Thank you very much, Professor Bojumdar, for the very kind introduction, and needless to say, many thanks to Presidency University for the honor of asking me to speak here. It's a very great pleasure, the slightly destabilizing one, to return to my alma mater in this wonderful new guise, and must congratulate Professor Lohia and all the colleagues for having brought about this transformation. This is a little disorienting to us who saw it, this more shabbier, but still, even then, very lively guise until 25 years ago. Anyway, my title today is Harnessing the Humanities, a title that may seem perverse, because a harness confines and controls. It impedes the expansion of the mind and uplifting of the spirit, traditionally credited to the humanities, even more than other branches of inquiry, as Sugato has so eloquently brought out to us. Friedrich Schiller has a poem where the winged horse Pegasus is put in harness to the misfortune of both the creature and the people tormenting him. Finally, a young man with a lute sends him soaring into the skies. That is an allegory of the function of the arts. The term humanities originates historically in the new curriculum of European universities in the Renaissance as a study of more humanly oriented texts, literae humaniores, ancient Greco-Roman literature, history and philosophy in particular, in contrast to divinity or theology based on the word of the Christian God. Today, the term humanities embraces the many diverse disciplines studying the arts and patterns of mental and social behavior. To harness the humanities, it might seem, is to stunt and abuse the material. That is often adjudged the unhappy task of the academic student of the humanities. Jivanananda Das has an unsparing metaphor for the literary scholar's pursuit. Not only does the scholar not write poetry, he dabbles among the worms infesting the entrails of dead poets. Mrithokovider Krimikete. I think all Bengalis will remember that devastating image. Actually, every scholar in the field must have felt like endorsing this description at some point in their career, and even more damningly, they might unknowingly have matched it. But worms, after all, are living creatures in their own right. So can they bring life to the scholar's dismal pursuit? In what follows, I will talk chiefly about the sphere of the humanities with which I am concerned, namely literary studies. But literature being a term of very uncertain meaning, I don't know what it means. And I almost feel like saying I challenge anybody to do so, but there are people in the audience who might take up the challenge successfully, so I won't. But anyway, it's a tricky term. Okay? So I prefer to call it the study of verbal texts. We could have called it textual studies, but unfortunately the term is traditionally associated only with a small part of the field. Mutatis mutandis, my arguments should apply closely to the study of all the arts, less closely but substantially to the history and the social sciences. I will say a little bit about history at one point of my paper. Maybe what I'll say will apply least of all to the truncated discipline that we call philosophy, which I think in a discerning knowledge order would be grouped with the fundamental sciences. Analytic studies in the humanities, especially studies of artistic creations, and the study of anything by definition has to be analytic. But analytic studies of the humanities challenges two shibboleths. One of them holds that the material of the humanities forms a self-contained, self-sufficient order to be justified solely in its unique terms, and that to view it in any broader context does violence to its nature. The other holds that this material is so subtle and so elusively constituted that it can only be assessed in intuitive terms. That is to say, it cannot, strictly speaking, be analyzed at all. In particular, it cannot be quantified. This supposedly traditional attitude towards the humanities is of relatively recent origin. In classical times, whether in India or in the West, scholastic commentary engaged in close and sometimes excessive analysis of the language of a text. In the West, such analysis was an application of the time-honored discipline of rhetoric. The later and more complex field of poetics, certainly I say later because Aristotle did not call his brief tract by that name. That name, that title, Aristotle's Poetics, that evolved virtually through the chance ascription of titles in later manuscripts. So by and large, poetics, and what we today call poetics, is a later, it's a more complex field that branched out, compared to rhetoric, into a more diffuse range of structural issues where thematic implications were explored. This process of thematic inquiry began for all practical purposes no earlier than the 18th or even 19th century, depending on which nation and which language we are talking about. I leave it to experts in classical Indian literature to tell us whether the tracing of broad thematic structures in a work, as opposed to the implications of specific phrases, verses, or passages, can be ascribed to Western influence since the 19th century. In any event, this kind of thematic and aesthetic mapping of texts at both overall and local levels dominated the academic interpretation of literature through most of the 20th century. It is the critical practice, broadly unified, though with endless variations, sustaining the rise of English literature faculties in universities across the world through the 20th century. It is the line we inherited from at least our grandparents' day, indeed our great-grandparents' day. In our own generation, some of us in Kolkata had the benefit of intensive training along these lines from a group of outstanding teachers at Presidency College. This critical practice was underpinned. This critical practice was underpinned by a set of formal, or we might loosely say technical, concepts relating to genre, structure, tropes, and style. Texts would also be related to their social and historical context of production, often leading to a false etymological notion of context as context, something accompanying a text, which is not, in fact, the root meaning of the word. However, except in declaredly specialist studies, such formal and contextual inquiry was always incidental to the principal business of extracting the intellectual design inherent in the verbal design. Everything else was background. Its relation to the text strictly one way, as a set of common circumstances generating an outstanding work by a chemistry that would not bear close analysis. To anticipate my later argument, this was a position challenged by the late 20th century critical development called New Historicism. The chief purpose of this traditional mode of analysis, and we can fitly call it analysis, often both exacting and complex, its chief purpose was to explore the implications of the text at all levels, starting from the phrase, line, or sentence, and organizing these into a total intellectual structure reflecting the mind and intent of the author. Critics regularly alerted us to the danger of the so-called intentionist fallacy of confining our interpretation to the author's presumed conscious purpose. Nonetheless, this critical methodology focused closely on authorial provenance, or at most on a group of authors or a literary period viewed as a consortium of individuals rather than a social or historical process. An aesthetic assessment of their work or works, favorable in default mode, was an implicit part of the exercise. A very large part of English literary criticism still conforms to this pattern. But about half a century ago, the feeling began to grow that the line had crossed the point of diminishing return and indeed was in danger of implosion. Enterprising scholars were prompted to look outwards at other prospects, unexplored and sometimes forbidding, but promising fresh insights and, for the first time on any scale, applications of textual analysis. The single biggest impetus came from what has, unfortunately but irrevocably, come to be called theory. The theory, as it were, with a capital T, not just theory of this or that, but the collective term for a range of speculative and abstractive inquiry, often related or even incompatible. Certain fields of theory, that the post-structuralism associated with Jacques Derrida are basically concerned with language and texts. Others, like structuralism, number textual constructs among several major applications that it might relate to good effect. Yet others, like feminism or psychoanalysis, do not primarily relate to texts at all. Some, like postcolonialism and new historicism, generate their own theory around historical and sociological premises. The age of theory has seen more obfuscation and no less cliched and slipshod thinking than most earlier phases of critical history. But it has also been the single greatest force by far in freeing the study of texts from earlier outworn cliches and practices, charging it with new energy and, more crucially, new functions and new ends. It has impressed academia with the perception that texts can be studied for ends that are not solipsist, that are not turned inwards towards the text, but outwards towards other sectors of experience. This is, again, not uniformly true of all bodies of theory, much less so, for instance, of Derrida and post-structuralism than of feminism or post-colonialism. But by providing a rationale for the radical reinterpretation of texts, the Derridaean notion of deconstruction has defined the methodology of other branches of theoretical inquiry with more practical ends. For good and bad, the study of texts has moved away from the tacit liberal humanism commonly impregnating it in the Anglophone world to other ideological positions. In fact, it has asserted the role of ideological positions in textual analysis in a way that liberal humanism had evaded and implicitly denied. I do not have time to assess the impact of specific fields of theory on the study of texts. I can only note some general consequences. First of all, theoretical factors have made for a radical reordering of the literary canon. It is not only a matter of adding new authors and titles, but of redefining the principles of canon formation. The traditional literary canon, in English as in most other languages and cultures, have been ostensibly aesthetic, whatever forces of cultural politics might have operated in the background. It might have changed over time, sometimes quite markedly, but in response to a revised aesthetics. For the first time, we now see the canon changing to openly accommodate social and historical factors, gender, subalternism, colonialism, other platforms for what we might term positive discrimination in cultural choice. Aesthetic criteria are no longer paramount. Or maybe to put it more correctly, we are witnessing a new aesthetics conditioned by social and political factors. In other words, an aesthetics that is not purely aesthetic. Literary excellence, as conventionally defined, is no longer the sole guiding principle. Its importance has declined and can, on occasion, be virtually dismissed. Canon formation has become a more inclusive exercise, governed by a reevaluation of the social function of literature. Canon formation, of course, is a phenomenon of reception, not of creation. I'm not talking of the socializing of actual works of literature or art, but of their academic analysis. The artist might hold any position, from the markedly aestheticist to the markedly propagandist. The new aesthetics operates across the whole spectrum of artistic commitment. What matters is not the constitution of the original work, but the terms of its analysis by the scholar or interpreter. And what matters to my argument, I mean, of course, I don't mean what matters the wider cultural context. Much more than before, the scholar now orients his analysis externally and contextually to explore its social implications in one direction, and thus necessarily its epistemological implications in another. The work of art is seen as a contingent artifact located in time and space, bound by the specifics of its social context rather than any formal absolutes. It thereby generates a different kind of knowledge, linking the conventional categories of artistic and non-artistic discourse, conventionally literary works and non-literary constructs that articulate the wider discursive genius of the age. This new epistemology of canon-neutral documentation is the precise recourse of new historicism, and a crucial resort of feminist and post-colonial interpretation. Here, a play by Shakespeare takes its place within the same discourse as a political dispatch, a letter or diary, and a painting, and perhaps with events and scenes and issues of later periods or even today. This latter category of non-literary or non-artistic witnesses is the central concern of other disciplines like social history, political history, or art history. The association of literary and historical studies is particularly illuminating, as history is the other major discipline that, by however different methods, for whatever different purposes, intensively studies texts and documents. I can at last bring another discipline into my argument when my audience must have dispersed of my ever doing so. I am not talking of the hoary scholarly sport of trawling literary texts for historical allegory. In fact, that sport has grown somewhat out of fashion, mercifully. It sought to find elements of political or military history preserved intact beneath the fictional surface. What I have in mind is an inquiry after hitherto unexplored human and social consequences of that political or military history. The latter's presence in the elusive processes of society and the individual mind as expressed in literary texts. This is not a naive interdisciplinarity that merely juxtaposes two different sectors of inquiry, studying different methods, applying different methods to different material. Rather, each model is invaded by the other, adopting yet modifying each other's methods, altering the status of the material studied by each. Political, military, or economic records normally studied by the historian are read by literary scholars for the way their concrete records crystallize the subtle, diffuse, and inchoate processes of society and the human mind as reflected in literature. Conversely, texts forming the literary canon are read by the historian for the intellectual and affective illustration of the political, military, or economic setting. Hence arise the long familiar field of social history and the somewhat more recent, though still well established, field of emotional history. Each set of witnesses is drawn into the service of an unaccustomed discourse, a new sector of knowledge. That is what I mean by redefining the epistemology of a discipline. Conventionally disparate disciplines, here literature and history, impregnate each other in terms of content, method, and purpose. My account is not abstruse enough, I will not draw it further in that direction. The crucial point is that the humanistic study of texts, I'm using humanistic here as a kind of adjectival form of the humanities, there is really no good adjective corresponding to the noun humanities. Humanist will not do it, it means something else, a much more specialized meaning. So I'm using the adjective humanistic for the nonce to mean relating to the humanities. The crucial point is that the humanistic study of texts, the literature, to revert to the nomenclature I decried at the start, but inevitably need to employ, is no longer justifying itself in its own terms, but in those drawn from another discipline openly bearing upon the world outside it. I can proceed to my next and most crucial point. In most of the theory-based lines of inquiry I cited earlier, conventional literary and historical studies were both being harnessed, and here I use the word harnessed in a simple and unstressed way, to the service of an activist agenda drawing on contemporary social concerns and values. The place and role of women, the accommodation of the mind to its environment, the relations between races and communities, the relations between nations, which are the concerns respectively of feminist, psychoanalytic, ethnic, and postcolonial schools of humanistic studies. The center of gravity in the humanities has shifted decisively from self-contained academic exercises within an exclusive value system to an externally defined, externally oriented value system and epistemology. The challenge thus arises how to serve these new externally oriented functions in a manner appropriate to the methodology of these disciplines and how to adapt that methodology to these new applications. The common run of Marxist literary criticism, though emphatically not many of its outstanding exponents, would accommodate a great deal of what others might consider mere propaganda without the formal characteristics demanded of texts usually designated as literature. At the other extreme, every conference goer knows all too well the reduction of humane, intrinsically activist theory to fine-spun, abstract, and, in the worst sense, academic exercises disjunct from any reformist agenda on the ground. Finally, no doubt, the turning of an academic discipline to any cause, however activist in bent, will and perhaps should be academic in the sense of providing the intellectual rationale and critique of a social agenda, preventing the practical from lapsing into the merely pragmatic. The problem arises when that intellectual exercise is cut off from a vitalizing relationship with the practical agenda, however stridently it might profess a notional commitment or even undertake a shadow play of activism. All too often, in academic departments across the world, social and political movements involving profound, often bloody sacrifice by others on the ground are deftly hijacked, I will not say harnessed, to the ends of careerism and self-gratification, reducing an agenda of proactive reform to barren theorizing. That does not negate the fact that these theoretical concerns have, virtually for the first time in modern academic history, or any academic history, in any age, attempted on any scale to relate humanistic studies to social issues and agendas. Earlier wisdom, once generally defended, then more and more questioned or even satirized, held that a sound education in canonical texts in a designedly removed academic environment best fitted a man, and it was a man by patriarchal default, for the supremely practical task of governing a country. This was, and in some measure is, the position of traditional British governance, hence adopted through most of the Anglophone world and its former colonies. A similar program is said to have empowered the mandarins in traditional Chinese society. It seems fair to say that only in very recent times, impelled by the theoretical concerns that I have outlined, have humanities faculties and universities opened their mental windows to the world outside, while direct political action on campus has nearly always caused destruction, physical destruction, and little else. I should add at once that this is emphatically not so with other activist agendas, for instance, those asserting to the rights and needs of women, disadvantaged social groups, or persons with special physical needs. Here, a constructive, if incomplete, transformation has taken place in campuses across the world, both in policy and in material construction. And the ideological impetus behind this change has come, more often than not, from humanities departments. That in itself is a resounding justification for the new turn in humanistic studies. They have been harnessed, so to speak, to a triumphal chariot. Let me move on to another point that may or may not be related. The uncertainty of the connection that may or may not is part of my point. It is more or less accepted that for good or bad, and again, the uncertainty is significant, the great age of theory is over, partly perhaps because it has achieved many of its practical ends on the academic soil beyond which most faculty and students do not venture even today. Even more importantly, literature departments the world over, and also departments in history and the social sciences, have radically revised their curricula in line with these changes. At the same time, there has been a certain unease with the abstraction inherent in theory, virtually by definition. Especially relevant are the irresistible but recondite and controversial speculations on the word and the text identified with Jacques Derrida and his line of post-structuralism. On the rebound, they might have played a part in a greater, more theorized interest in the material text, the book or manuscript or electronic file that physically embodies, in the literal sense, embodies the words as distinct from the intellectually apprehended structure of meaning built up by the words as signs. The material text had earlier been the concern only of specialized branches of literary scholarship, bibliography, or the study of material witnesses as such, and the editorial concerns to which alone the term textual studies had sadly been confined. These were severely concrete and practical in bent. But now we have the emergence of editorial theory, which would earlier have been considered a virtual oxymoron. Editorial theory is necessarily grounded theory. That's the best thing about it, unlike many other kinds of theory. It expounds general insights into the nature of texts, derived by editors through their engagement with specific texts. It cannot be developed without such specific reference. One may say it allows scholars to eat the theoretical cake and have it too. It also activates the broader pursuit of textual theory, which I would argue to be radically different from the theory of language generally, though branching out from it. The theory of language engages with the operation of language per se, the generation and reception of meaning through signs. Textual theory belongs one step up. It addresses the realized products or compositions of language, integral texts composed using language, with special attention to the social and material conditions of production and the philosophical implications of the task. Now, this could be said of a great deal of literary criticism, but textual theory is not concerned with the thematic, structural, or aesthetic aspect of those texts. Its purpose is not interpretative. It studies the way in which all texts operate and circulate, the general conditions in which particular texts convey their particular meanings, which are not the concern of textual theory. That is not the direct concern. It has to be taken into account, of course. The new expansion of textual theories, of textual studies, has contributed to a still greater revolution. It has induced a view of texts, indeed of all subject material of the humanities, in a way that prepared humanistic scholarship for the coming of the computer. I have remarked elsewhere that if the computer had not come into being by other means, textual scholars and theorists would have had to invent it, if they could, of course they couldn't, sadly. But they have, because textual scholars and theorists had habitually embraced analytic practices now radically advanced by the use of the computer, but earlier envisaged and carried out by other less adequate means. There is a book called The Renaissance Computer that describes the methods which the Renaissance employed and in good measure created for the tasks for which we now use computers. I'm emphatically not proposing a distinction between a technical or mechanical branch of literary scholarship and an intuitive or effective core discipline. On the contrary, I would hold any such division to be invalid. But textual studies makes most visible use of concrete evidence in ordered and sometimes quantifiable ways, so that the computer is of greatest and most obvious use to this branch of textual of study of texts generally. The computer enables us to process large quantities of textual data, like all other kinds of data, with hitherto undreamt of speed and accuracy. Hence, to prepare textual corpora and concordances, classified lists of all the words in an author's work or other body of texts. It enables us to carry out major exercises in collation, the comparison of different versions of a work, and order the output in ready form for further analysis. The collation software Collate, currently housed at Saskatoon University in Canada, has compared 58 versions of Chaucer's Canterbury Tales and worked out a stemma or family tree, grouping them by varying degrees of correspondence. Another collation software, Probhate, developed and housed at Jadavpur University, has compared virtually all versions, sometimes as many as 20, of Tagore's vast corpus in Bengali and English at three levels. First, the canto, scene, or chapter, not chunks, then narrowing it down to the particular stanza, speech, or paragraph, and finally, to the individual word. Such exercises would have been not only impossible, but virtually inconceivable without the resources of the computer. The important point is that this processing of Chaucer's or Tagore's text are not exercises in simple quantification. They do not represent an updated version of the kind of fatuous inquiry in T.S. Eliot's example of counting how many times giraffes are mentioned in the English novel. In fact, there is nothing quantitative or technical about the conclusions finally enabled by such data mining. They support the traditional agenda for the study of creative literature, as do other applications of computational text analysis. Besides collation, another major group of programs relate to the kind of exercise exemplified by topic modeling, but going beyond what is commonly called topic modeling. In other words, locating sets or clusters of words recurring through a body of texts with the end of determining the common salient concerns. I should imagine that these kind of analyses would be extremely relevant and illuminating with historical documents or historical study. Advanced exercises in this field can explore basic features of the textual condition, linking up with computational linguistics, as in the exciting mapping metaphor project of the University of Glasgow. Collation and topic modeling programs work through highly refined applications of the search function. So, I would venture to suggest, do virtually all programs of computational text analysis. They hunt out every occurrence of relevant words, or sometimes their non-occurrence, as with collation, and examine the patterns they form to prove or disprove an interpretative point. In other words, they provide an unprecedentedly efficacious tool for scholars to carry out much the same tasks as in the pre-computer era. But the computer also enables critical tasks that were earlier so far beyond our reach as to be effectively unthinkable. For instance, the practice of distant reading, which is not the precise opposite of the time-honored exercise called closed reading. This is distant reading as proposed by Franco Moretti of Stanford University, whereby we do not probe the details of a particular text, but examine its place in a vast process of textual circulation and interaction. This is an exercise in tracking rather than reading, but it defines the milieu or context of a work more scrupulously than earlier scholars could have dreamt of, which may be why they did not dare dream of it until it arrived at the doorstep. To repeat my opening point, computational analysis of art in any medium has been decried as reducing the intuitive, affective principles of aesthetically distinguished material to crudely mechanical and quantitative terms. I once had a piquant discussion with a noted scholar of medieval European music. He insisted to the last that this music was too subtle and complex for computer analysis, although I reminded him that medieval European culture specifically associated music with mathematics as a component of the quadrivium, or fourfold path of knowledge, of which the other three were arithmetic, geometry, and astronomy. The computer fundamentally challenges any assertion that a line of inquiry is too complex to be resolved by mechanical means. A computer is indeed a machine, a truth we should not forget and to which I will later return, but it enables far more refined and intricate analysis than the unaided human faculties. The more complex and elusive an issue is, the more justification, not less, for turning to the computer. It is simply perverse to deny the instrument's powers of disentangling the complex. Digital humanities is a nascent discipline, or sub-discipline, but it will assuredly play a crucial role in humanistic studies in the future, along the lines of textual studies in conventional literary research. This is a major procedural consequence, which in turn has profound intellectual implications. The humanities are adopting on some scale the standard research practice of the sciences and even social sciences, namely team-based, project-oriented research. To extract and process huge quantities of data on the computer calls for specialized technicals, often not commanded by the student of pure humanities. The next generation will surely see a new category of academic workers skilled in both humanistic and computational principles. It is the duty of our universities to train such personnel and ensure their employment in the pursuit of knowledge. At a more general level, computational analysis calls for a great deal of preliminary data processing that specialized scholars cannot and need not carry out hands-on. As in much scientific research, they need only provide the guiding intelligence. Yet, and this again is a fundamental point, we cannot, in this instance as in most others, simply transfer the research practices of science to the humanities, especially to the study of the arts. This is because the material of the arts, a poem, a painting, a piece of music, generates an intuitive response in the people for whom it is primarily meant. And to generate this response is the primary purpose of art. No quantitative or other scientific analysis can dismiss this intuitive response. Rather, it must analyze the factors behind that response, behind that intuition, conducting its factual or quantitative inquiry against a control model that is necessarily and intrinsically intuitive, as it cannot be in the sciences. Even the great scientists often say that the research is guided by an intuitive vision. I'm on my last page. This amounts to say that human analysis of the computer analysis, the application of a controlling intelligence guiding the collection and processing of data, is, I will not say more necessary, for it is vital everywhere, but more evidently and intensively, even invasively necessary in humanistic inquiry. It calls for an open, explicit dialogue between the human and the machine, each stage of data analysis being reviewed by the human intelligence and returned to the computer for the next level of analysis in the light of its earlier findings. In the process, the human will also have reviewed and fine-tuned his or her own intuitive apprehension at the start. I repeat that I'm not so foolish as to hold that this dialogic process is absent in scientific research. I'm sure it is no less crucial there in all fields of research. But for the reason I have suggested, that initial anchoring in intuition, the digital humanities might serve specially to make it a prominent article of the philosophy of computational analysis. Ultimately, all research is generated by the human mind working in the solitude of its own absorbed energy. Its best icon is the scholar in his study, in splendid withdrawal from the distractions of the world. But those who read English at Presidency College in the 1960s, that image will indelibly take the form of Professor Tarabnath Sen sitting in a little island of light in the dark and cavernous arts library at an hour close to midnight. As the poet Yeats puts it, in lines now inscribed in a plaque in that library, and that Chopin has just assured me will be preserved even if the partition walls are pulled down, "Truth flourishes where the student's lamp has shone, and there alone." But today, the student's lamp might be reflected and magnified on the screens of 1,000 computers. This makes it easier to give socialized form to the pristine scholarly energy emanating from the individual intellect, whereby the inquirer comes to terms with himself or herself. More than ever before, the inquirer can now also muster a dedicated band, dedicated in both senses, and committed to the task, and also specially devoted to the task, and circulate the results to a public, which, through the electronic media, is potentially worldwide in a vastly more intensive way than in the age of print. We are living through one of the greatest knowledge revolutions in human history. In my view, the digital revolution is greater than the transition from manuscript to print. It can be compared only to the passage from orality to writing. It is not only a technological, but a profound epistemological revolution, altering our concept of knowledge and the means of attaining to it. The humanities have as much to gain from it as any other sphere of the intellect. It is my suspicion that they have just as much to contribute. Thank you.
Well, I didn't withhold my temptation to describe Professor Sukanta Chaudhuri as a polymath of the humanities. And now I'm tempted to say that we got a glimpse of his mind, a non-Puritan mind, a non-orthogonal mind. He started with pure literature and talked about digital linguistics, digital extraction of verbal texts. This is wonderful. It's really been an experience sitting through and listening to you. I've read some of your work, but never listened to you before. It's been a real experience for me, as I'm sure for the audience. Questions for Professor Chaudhuri?
I hope I'm not depriving time for a student to ask the question. But I want to raise this issue of neuroaesthetics and the new development in neurobiology as it relates to human ability to make speeches. particular area designated in the brain to make sentences and syntax. Issues such as dyslexia, propensity to make certain sentences, repetition, all these things coming under scrutiny through neurobiology. And when I thought about this about 15 years ago, in fact, in Bangla, I wrote a book on this issue and researched it. And it seemed to me that the whole thing was started by Noam Chomsky when he presented his idea of universal grammar, and then his student like Pinker and others. And as you just mentioned, people like Derrida and Foucault and others, you know, took it in a very different direction. So given that we know we got the speech through evolution, there was a time when proto-humans could not speak, and then they spoke. So whatever text they're producing now, and the fact that the text itself has now has its life of its own, but ultimately we ought to be able to relate it to the biological endowment and areas in the brain which is making this speech. Would you comment on that?
But actually, I have prevented from making any fruitful comment by my total ignorance of the fields that you're talking about, you know, the neuroscience behind the faculty of speech and how it operates in the actual practice of language. Branches out from neuroscience in one direction towards computational, towards linguistics, and now therefore computational linguistics in another direction towards artificial intelligence and cognitive science. Now, what I'm talking about is something different and, I hate to say this, but simpler and maybe finally less challenging in complex. It is the function of the texts which are formed as the ultimate outcome of these processes. You know, to take a very crude analogy, the fully constructed car is driven on the road rather than the process of assembling that car, let alone of extracting the metal and creating the components out of which it is built. So these, of course, these are ultimately related, but at the same time, the relationship is so far-flung and so complex that I think scholars in particular fields, and certainly the field that I'm talking about, can only engage with a small part of it, I'm afraid.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful speech. My question.
Sorry,
is that
where are you?
Stand up.
Over there. Okay, right. Yes.
So, thank you for the wonderful speech. My question is that since you have mentioned about the importance of computational analysis in the field of humanities, what would you say about training humanities students in computer science and computer programming and or mathematics? Maybe even as electives or in our case, say like GenEd. Especially due to the contributions it can make in cross-disciplinary fields such as artificial intelligence.
If humanities students, again, from a position of almost complete ignorance, if a humanities student wants to engage with artificial intelligence, he'll have to undergo a very great deal of special training. But as far as humanities, the need for humanities students to acquire some training in the principles of computer use, not just word processing or internet browsing, but the principles of computation, computational analysis, should I say the philosophy of computational analysis, that I think is very necessary. Now, how it is, whether there's a subsidiary course or through special programs or whatever, that must be left to universities or to the other sort of training agencies and programs. But something of this sort is necessary. And may I just add a few sentences about what seems to be a crying need, which is to give some rudimentary training in mathematics to all students of the humanities. This is something which we never had. Once upon a time, long, long ago, students in even maybe the pure sciences, certainly of engineering, in places like Jadavpur and what was then the Bengal Engineering College at Shibpur, the students of engineering would be given some training in humanities too, within course, humanize them, so they didn't simply grow up learning how to have a piece of metal, as it were. That was the crude and derogatory idea of engineering then current, of the applied sciences then current. Now, of course, the wheel has turned. I was the engineer who looks down on the humanities scholar as somebody who sort of failed to pass the joint entrance. But it meant that, when I went to school, more decades ago than I'm going to confess, we had to decide which stream we wanted to study in class 8. I've never learned any mathematics in my life to speak of beyond simple arithmetic and geometry. And I mean, I got through life more or less without too many problems. But now, see, engaging with computers, I'm beginning to feel, this crucial lack in my education, I should say. And I think practically everybody sitting here who's been trained in the humanities suffers from this lack. So, I mean, there is still some kind of residual need felt to train students of the sciences, pure or applied, in certain fields of the humanities, at least in the use of language. Or even if they are not formally trained in it, they, of their own accord, they read literature, they listen to music, they get some exposure. But I think there's very few students of humanities who, out of pleasure, in leisurely moments, cultivate the mathematics. This is something crucial. And, I just noticed Professor Lohia clapping very loudly when I said that. If you could introduce some such component in the curricula of Presidency University, that would really be a great contribution. Well, if you do not want to also humanities students, if at the age of 66 you do not want to lament your lack of training in the math, I assure you, by the time you people reach 66, if global warming allows you to do so, which is a very real risk, then it's not something to laugh about, it's a very real risk, I'm sorry to say, then you will find that the need for humanities, for applicative humanities, of mathematics in your work, probably grows much greater than it is today. Okay.